Okay. We will get started. Welcome. Thank you for coming. This presentation is called Oboe, which caused more than a few difficulties with the IDRS people because they didn't quite put it correctly in the program, in the schedule. It's something I think that is new, brand new to IDRS. I don't think anybody's ever done this before. A lecture demonstration with the possibility to try instruments, Baroque instruments. So I hope this works out. Let's get started. There's a lot of material, a lot of history here. I'm going to have to probably skip over some of it, maybe most of it, depending on how time goes. But it's all in the handouts. Did everybody get a handout? So all the details are there. And if I don't talk about everything, you'll understand why. Okay, so let's get started. Oh, I wanted to ask before we start. I assume you're all oboists? Are there any bassoonists in the crowd? No. How many people own a Baroque oboe or have played it or touched one or been within 10 feet of it?
All right.
So here we go. A bit of history, but not too much, I hope. So the first thing we have to talk about is nomenclature. So obviously the French word for oboe is hautboy, right? And that was both the word they used for the shawm and then later the oboe. And it's a word that means, there's some debate about it, but it means either high or loud woodwind. And really in the Renaissance it referred to the haut and bas ensembles, the loud and soft ensembles, and the shawm was definitely a member of the loud ensemble. But prior to 1750, the word was pronounced Oboe. So in 1750, when the French Academy was formed, they decided to change the pronunciation. Actually, I think what they did is they adopted the posh pronunciation, and the more common place, Oboe, went away and became Oboa, right? So when the Italians took over the oboe, they transliterated it. And they spelled it exactly as they would as if it was Italian, Oboe. The Germans, with their pension for borrowing, they borrowed both terms. So did the Spanish. The Spanish borrowed the more or less the Italian version, the Dutch. But then when you get to England in the 17th, 18th century, they had their own term, somewhat bolderized. They called it the hautboy. This is an actual English word. It was used, is what Henry Purcell and George Frederick Handel called the oboe. They called it the hautboy, or maybe hautboy. There's some debate about whether the H was pronounced. So that's the origin of this strange word, hautboy. But it is a genuine English word for the oboe.
It's in the dictionary.
It's in the dictionary, probably.
That's right.
Too.
It is. I looked it up.
So, just a word about that. The famous scholar Bruce Haynes, he proposed that we use this word to designate Baroque oboe, not Baroque oboe, because the two-keyed oboe, as you get later in the 18th century, is no longer Baroque. So you really can't call it a Baroque oboe anymore. So hautboy was his suggestion for a more appropriate term. And that's what I intend to use in this presentation. So obviously the ancestor was the shawm, the consort oboe. In the medieval and Renaissance times, it had mostly a diatonic scale. There were a few accidentals that so you could play, you know, F sharp and flat and Renaissance music. Yes.
I believe the presentation
starts. Oh, it does.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
So you might want to wait a few more minutes. You start because you slipped.
Oh. Yeah.
Yep, that's it, thank you.
Oh, I apologize, it must have been in here, so, okay. A little more time, you want to see what you mean? I'll get started.
Yeah, we just figured from the...
Mindset.
We made their schedule together.
It says two online, apparently. Yeah, it said two online, that's what I recognized.
Did you learn about the whole tunnel game your second ago? Because that was the
No, we went to a concert over in the theater.
Then you just never have to come back. No,
sorry, one can try.
You'll have to.
Yeah.
Could I ask one thing though? In the back there, I have my iPhone in the morning.
Yeah, her head's in the way.
So I think if you go that way and I go this way.
Oh, yeah, that'll help too. Because unlike some other conferences, they don't record the master classes and whatnot. Okay, so I'll backtrack slightly.
Starts with 15, yes.
I do have Iva Shom, and it'll mine'll finger chromatically with fork fingerings, like you get about an octave and a fifth if you overblow. So,
I mean, some chromatics, most chromatics are there, but sometimes on some models they're not.
Yeah.
We might have time though for going to the thing at the
end. We'll try it up here.
Yeah, but it's like right down the hall. Okay. It's like also on this floor. So I figured like a minute or two late, what are they gonna do?
No. Yeah, I think so, obviously. Yeah.
What a bad thing.
nomenclature, we don't know that the word Oboe is the French word for oboe, right? Where are we going? A couple more pieces. So that the word Oboe in French, you know, high woodwind or loud woodwind, before 1750 was pronounced Oboe. And when the French Academy was established in the mid-1700s, they changed the pronunciation of this and many other words. So, you know, for example, moi was way. I guess it was, they were adopting the posh pronunciation of cork. And probably the common people said, oh boy, oh moi, oh boy, I mean, and the court said, oh moi. So this is where the Italian term comes from, Oboe, and then we have the English word, which is sort of a weirdo. The English called it Hautboy in the 18th century. This is an actual English word. It's what Handel would have called the oboe. So, and that is a term that's been proposed to replace the term Baroque oboe, because when you get into the later 18th century, it's not Baroque anymore. Music has changed. So, Hautboy, that's Bruce Haynes' term, is really more appropriate. That's what I'll use in this presentation. So we have the Shawm, the ancestor of the oboe, the consort oboe. The early models only went up maybe about a ninth, and then later on they were able to maybe do an octave and a fifth. But the main difference was that it was played with a pirouette, kind of mouthpiece, which meant that you had very little control over the reed. But beginning in the mid-17th century, there was a family of bagpipe makers in Normandy who moved to Paris to become instrument makers for the court. And they began redesigning Renaissance woodwind, and one of these was the Shawm. They created something called the protomorphic Hautboy. It actually had the same bore as the Shawm, but they lengthened the instrument. They lowered it by a minor third or so. It gave twinned holes for accidentals, which the Shawm didn't have. Most importantly, it had a freestanding reed, so it was capable of being played much more expressively, much controlled volume, and so on. It possibly was first used by Jean-Baptiste Lully in his ballad L'Amour Malade, 1657. But after 1664, there's no record of the hautboy being used. But sometime after 1664, for the pocketeurs and ultimately also the pilladors, they redesigned the hautboy even more, and the true French hautboy appeared. It was first used probably in 1670 in Louis Ballet, or Ballet du Cour, in the Bourgeois Gentilhomme. It had a range of C to D, so two octaves in the tone. It was pitched approximately a minor third lower than modern. So if you played a C on it, C major scale, you'd get an A major scale. It was fully chromatic, except it didn't have a low C sharp. A wide dynamic range with an expressive vocal-like timbre, and it was used extensively in obbligatos and opera, where it imitated the voice. It was the main instrument in Le Grand Lecture B, which was the big whole band of the court. 1664, Lully assumed control of the Constant Guillaume de Bois, the 24 violins of the king. And later he adds winds from the Grand Cuvée, which were, in this case, would have been oboes, recorders, flutes, bassoons. He adds that to strings, and in effect creates the modern orchestra. I mean, it's an amazing moment in music when you think about it. So the only evidence of these early designs is a series of tapestries called the Gobelin. Gobelin is a factory, and it still exists in Paris, where they make tapestries. So this is a picture of a shepherd playing early in Hautboy, he's playing a fictitious note. You know, you wouldn't get it. So, the Amomi. In the 17th and 18th centuries, the Hautboy ensemble, or Amomi, which is just French for wind band, was the most common place that you would have heard the Hautboy played. Most Hautboys played in bands and not orchestras. So in 1653, Jean-Baptiste Lully assumes control of the Grand Écurie, which has various groups in it. The original bass instrument, actually I brought my Baroque bassoon, I had put it together and sort of incidental, but the original bass instrument in the harmony was something called the basque formon. And you can see a picture of it here at the bottom. It was sort of like a long bagpipe chanter. That was the original bass instrument. Later, when the Potetaires redesigned the bassoon, created the four-piece bassoon, and then it, that became the bass. So a lot of composers wrote for it outside of, wrote for harmony outside of France, in 1685, so Louis XIV does a terrible thing. He revokes the Edict of Nantes, which granted tolerance to French Protestants, and it caused upwards of 500,000 to leave France. They were kicked out. And among them were the players of the newly invented oboe and bassoon. So they spread out over Europe. Even before that, some of them had made it to London. And you can see some of the dates listed there. Probably the most important one was Alexis Saint-Martin, who goes to the court of Milan. He changes his name to Sammartini, and he has two famous sons, Giuseppe and Giovanni. Giuseppe was probably the greatest Italian oboist of the 18th century. So oboes are show up in Nuremberg and Bern, in Switzerland, in Venice at San Marco, in Vienna, and Madrid. But interestingly, the oboe didn't stick in Spain. The oboe band was sent back after 5 years back to France. So despite Louis' terrible deed, all these famous players were born in the 1680s. And the most important one for us is Caspar Gleybisch. It's actually misspelled here. There should be a T in there. He was Bach's oboist. You'll hear more about him. So after 1700, the role of the hautboy in French music changes. Louis dies, Louis XIV is, he gets old and tired, and there's no more grand spectacles at court, and so the French turn to writing chamber music, symphonie. But there's actually no French music for hautboy, where it actually says that on the title page. It usually says violin or transverse flute. But here's a list of pieces that all work for hautboy. And that's probably how they were played back then. I mean, typical for the Baroque, you know, interchangeable instrumentation. But the interesting thing is that there are very few original instruments, French original instruments, that survived from this period. Just a handful. The Italians were the first to enthusiastically adopt the French hautboy. So you have a list of important dates. Bisman Tolba wrote the first treatise, 1688. 1694, hautboys were in Venice. 1696, Panatti debuted in San Marco on Christmas Day. This was also, coincidentally, the mark the debut of the young Vivaldi. So what else we have here? Well, for example, 1715, Albinoni's Concerti a Cinque were published, the first published concertos for oboe. 1716, the concertos for San Martini, by San Martini, Bampini, and Marcello are published by Roger in Amsterdam. After 1730, the Zotskis were the most famous family in Italy. The French Hautboy is a smash hit in German speaking lands. So you have already in 1678, Hautboys were being played at the opera at the Goose Market in Hamburg. Oboes were in Nuremberg and Dresden, 1694. This is a very important point. Dresden was the most celebrated orchestra in Europe. It had more virtuosos per square inch than anywhere else. And there's a list of some of the players. Interestingly, Franz, who was later the flute teacher to Frederick the Great, he was a section oboe player in began his career. 1712, Telemann takes up his post in Frankfurt. He imports two oboes, Georg Böhm and Jakob Denner, and Böhm was also his brother-in-law. The Hautboy in the London of George Frederick Handel. 1695 marks the death of Purcell and the appearance of Talbot's manuscript. This is the first actual written instructions how to interread. And there were all these players working at that time, most of them were French or not English. 1711, Handel's first London opera, Rinaldo. First, you know, Handel, in his youth, he was an Oboe player. He played in Hamburg and in Italy before he went to, he played a lot of things, but that was one of his plays. 1717, the water music. 1729, Giuseppe Sammartini moves to London. He was the most celebrated player there. 1749, music for the fireworks, probably the most famous piece for wind band, oboe band. So now we come to Leipzig, J.S. Bach, and Hautboy. And 1723, Bach assumes the post of cantor at the St. Thomas Church in Leipzig. He begins writing challenging solos for Kaspar Gleditsch. There are 193 Leipzig Hautboy solos, and all the greatest monument, this has been called the greatest monument of the talent of an oboe player in history of the instrument. Oboe d'amore was developed during his time. List of some of the builders and reason that Leipzig was had so many important builders, makers, was that it was a free trade city with no guilds. So we come to larger sizes of Hautboy. So in the Baroque you have the Oboe d'amore and the Tide. So the Oboe d'amore is a alto oboe in A with a softer veiled timbre. It was called, the Germans called it Oboe d'amour. They never used the Italian term. And it first appeared there in 1710. The repertoire is almost exclusively German, most of it by composers who were either from Leipzig or associated with it. So the question is, did Bach write at least two solo concertos for Hautboy d'amour, and do these survive in fragments for harpsichord, or for arrangements, I'm sorry, for harpsichord concertos, and there's the BWV listings. So you can refer to these articles that were in the double read written by Jeffrey Burgess that spells all that out. So the next instrument is taille, which simply means middle in French. And it's the generic term for any tenor hautboy in F. So the taille, the straight version, plays the tenor part in the oboe band. But in Bach's fours, he had two designations for the solos. He wrote Oboe da caccia, and for the pola parte or the piano, he wrote taille. But it probably always used almost always Oboe da caccia. And so we come to the infamous Oboe da caccia. Oboe in F, curved body with leather and fitted with a brass bell. It's been called the ultimate Baroque conceit. So what they did is they took a tenor oboe, bent it, covered it with leather, and put a brass bell on it, so as to simulate, to make you think it's some sort of hunting instrument, the concertina, right? It's the same tendering and technique as the descant oboe. Can be played either with an oboe style reed or bassoon style, but I would say most people use bassoon style reed nowadays. It works better. Almost all the music for oboe da caccia was written by Bach during his time in Leipzig. Now this blows my mind. There are exactly two surviving original oboes da caccia. They're both in Scandinavian museums, one in Denmark, one in Sweden. If these instruments hadn't come down to us, if they hadn't survived, we wouldn't know about this instrument. It would be. There aren't even any depictions of it in literature at the time, although obviously it shows up in Bach's scores. So the first copies of Oboe da caccia were made by Paul Hipper, an American, in 1973, used in recordings by the Vienna Consensus Musicus. So after 1750, the hoboy begins to evolve, the bore gets narrower, the tone holes are smaller, the range goes up to high F, the Mozart oboe quartet. Composers move away from writing Baroque forms, oboe trio and quartet, role in opera and orchestra changes, but during this time, the Viennese harmony, where it's just two oboes, two clarinets, two horns, two bassoons with double bass. Wonderful literature for that. After 1800, the slur keys and the chromatic keys were added, and paving way for the key system oboe that we all know. So maybe at this point, I should give you a little demo, right?
Yeah.
Called the A type A tube, built by all those different builders. Less than 400 originals survive. Had a compass, a two-octave, and a whole tone. No C sharp, no low C sharp. If it shows up in Baroque music, it should be there. No way to play it. Well, I take it back. There is a trick that I've seen people do. Sitting in a chair, holding this thing, and closing these two holes with your knees. But that's pretty damn hard. So, present day copies are pitched at 8/4/15, which is sort of the compromised Baroque pitch, but many were actually, originals were probably much lower, some were lower, 392, which is French low pitch. But there also were higher models, originals that were at 8/4/40, the Italian built many. So what you have, and when we get into the tryout, I'll go over this again, but there's fork fingerings, and they're still on modern Oboe, obviously. You have a fork F in both octaves, and you have a fork B flat in the lower octave. Did you realize, know that you actually have a fork F still on the modern Oboe? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because if you play A flat to B flat trill, you're creating a fork B flat. See what else. So the feature of this is the twinned holes, they're called. So this twinned hole here gives you close, gives you G, open gives you G sharp or A flat. This one gives you F sharp or G flat, but it's on the high side. Because most Baroque music is played in unequal temperament, it's really too sharp for F sharp as a leading tone, but we'll get into that later. So, interestingly, in the Baroque era, notes above A were produced like, sort of like the modern Oboe. There were short fingerings, A, B, B natural, and C was all fingers away. It's very hard to do. I don't know very many players who play that way. Most players these days, pros, people have to get up and play this thing in accordance with it. They play long fingerings. If anybody plays the Vienna Oboe, you know what I mean. So this is an A. Oh, this is an A. This is a long fingering for A. This is a long fingering for B flat. This is a long fingering for B natural, which is actually harmonic with E. And this is the high C long fingering, which is sort of a harmonic of E. So that is a major difference in technique between then and now. So the basic scales of C, D, E, F, G will probably be familiar to most oboists. Short, maybe the B flat, E flat. So here's a fingering chart that's in the back of your handout. There's a lot to say here, but I think the main thing is overblowing at the octave from B to A. You have to have a reed that does that. But it has to be balanced with a reed that also gives the fork fingerings. So, if you play an A in the lower octave, you have to be able to overblow with just a change in airspeed and a little bit of embouchure change, and a slight top. And that's one of the hardest things for modern oboists to accomplish, I think. But a reed that does that also has to play the low F. So those are two conflicting things, and building a reed that does that is a challenge. One of the interesting things to me about the Baroque Oboe is it has this ability to start and stop that you don't have in the modern Oboe. Because the modern Oboe, you're always playing this pressure and wind speed, and you're creating the sound, but the Baroque Oboe is more about speaking, about articulation. Well, I don't want to demonstrate that. But that's one of the key features, I think, of playing Baroque music. Okay, some of the other technical things. So the high C in the old fingering charts is pretty much impossible. I don't even try to play it. So people nowadays use the long finger. There's a thing called false trills on the Baroque Oboe. So there are certain trills that are really aren't there, but because of the way you play a Baroque trill with an appoggiatura, you don't know, you're not aware of this. So for example, the trill from B flat to A. I mean, nobody can do this, right? But you don't do that, because a Baroque trill consists of a long appoggiatura, a couple of wiggles, and then a resolution to the main note. The trill part is actually of lesser importance in Baroque music. Or the C to B. It's a major difference. And modern oboes tend to get hung up on the fact that there are no trill keys. Well, but you don't play trills the same way as you do. So here's a typical read, and we talked about overblowing, cross-fingering notes, and there's some details of some of the things I use to make reads. I won't go over that. Tone quality and vibrato. Early on, people wrote without actually having heard it, because the whole way was loud and strident and not ready for prime time. But there's a famous article by Joseph Marx who dispelled that belief. For example, Michel de Cure wrote in 1668, "Oboes make a stately sound, and played as they are nowadays at court and in Paris, they leave little to be desired. They make cadences as well as in tune, trills as sweet and diminutions as regular as the best instructed voice and the most perfect instruments." And John Bannister, this famous quote, "With a good reed, it, the hautboy, goes as easy and as soft as the flute. The hautboy is as majestical and stately and not much inferior to the trunk." Fons talked about how the hautboy was softer than the violoncello or bassoon, but louder than the traverso and the quarter, and some other things. Oh, vibrato. There was no such thing as breath vibrato back then. It was something which most people are nowadays are too scared to use. It's something called flattement. So if you play a long note, you do this. You'll hardly ever hear that. Aren't daring enough. Intonation and temperament. I mean, the hautboy, as with the modern hautboy, has a flexible pitch. So talking about temperament is kind of strange in this kind of. But the main concept here is major and minor semitones. This is for Baroque music. You have lowered leading tones and major thirds, and raised minor thirds and sixths. Want to play in tune. And there's an interesting temperament that Steve Hammer wrote about, you can reference there. So why play the hautboy, right? After all, the modern hautboy can do everything the hautboy can, right? Well, not exactly. But you have to talk about the hautboy's technical limitations. Key signatures only go up to maybe three sharps or flats. Certain trills, we talked about that. Certain passage work, going between D flat and E flat, because there's no side keys, right? So Bach loves to give you this passage. Going back and forth between these two keys, it just doesn't work. He even puts trills on D flat sometimes. Then the French wrote about canadier, which means literally to speak like a duck, and yeah, it does that sometimes. Slurring from a lower octave to the upper octave is pretty hard. And there's this famous quote by Telemann about how he writes for the Oboe. So this is the most important slide of all. And I, unfortunately, I can't really go into much detail. Something called rhetorical playing, the eloquent Oboe. Rhetorical style or historically informed performance nowadays versus modern longline or conservatory style. So the way we all learned how to play in music school, right? The long line, the tabutal line, the climax phrase. This is diametrically opposed to how they played in the 18th century. Rhetorical style was equated with oratory or eloquent speaking. The idea that you, as a performer, you engaged your audience, you actually had a kind of conversation with them. So I love this quote by Klotz. The aim of good performers is to win over the hearts of their listeners and to transport them first to this passion and to that. And in Henri Gaulle, his treatise, 1825, even shows the difference between the two. He says, examples of, and these are examples of the modern long line phrase and the frowned upon old fashioned papillotage. So already by that time it was out, but it's obviously back in. And elements of rhetorical style, no particular order, variable articulation in Baroque, there wasn't just slurred and tongue, there was degrees of articulation. And it's very hard to achieve that in the double read, but it's worth trying. And a quote from Matizon about scanning a phrase to find the good and bad beats. Beat hierarchy. This is sort of like the big four in jazz, you know. One, two, three, four. There are good and bad beats. Baroque phrasing consists of smaller motivic units and phrases, as opposed to long line phrasing in the 19th century. The ideas of gesture, that there was a whole catalog of figures or gestures in the Baroque, and people knew automatically how to inform them. For example, the Baroque sigh, da-da, da-da. So if a phrase is constructed of a bunch of Baroque sighs, you play them that way, you know, da-da, dee-da, dee-da, that would be boring. Da-da, dee-da, dee-da. Note shaping, bulging. For example, Leopold Mozart talked about the small softness that begins and ends each note. Silence is within the phrase. It's okay to interrupt a phrase with you know, silences. Flexible metronomic tempo. Tempo was not rigid and metronomic in the 17th, 18th century. Slurs were used for emphasis and not to mark legato. A slur is actually a kind of an accent or an emphasis in the world. Paired tongue, this is really interesting, especially for the instruments like the flute and recorder. They were able to do different tonguing for different notes. So, tudu, 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 or tivi, tivi. Again, very hard to do on double reed. Four or more 16th notes or 8th notes in a row are never played equally. The concept of pointing. And then finally, the idea of, in French music, the note en égale, where you have in a moderate tempo, you have a series of equal notes and they would actually be kind of swung. You know, you have da 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 written out, but it would come out da 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 da. And that was not notated. Automatic almost. So if you're interested in finding out more about rhetorical playing, I recommend Gonzalo Ruiz's Oboe Lesson Number 9, which talks about this on YouTube. Okay, so the revival in the 20th century, and we're getting close. So there are three towering figures who revived the Oboe. One of them, Michel Piguet, Swiss, and you can read some of this dates there. He had many notable students at the School of Conforum. Paul Hailthorne, Randall Cook, Stephen Hammer, Robin Howell, Marilyn Dano. You can hear a little bit of this playing. still on E minor. And then Bruce Haynes, this guy, I think is particularly important for me because he got me started on the Baroque Oboe. American, but he taught most of his career in the Netherlands and Montreal. And he wrote several very important books, which I highly recommend, and they're on the table here. This is a bibliography of music for the oboe, 1650 to 1800, and it should be in every oboist's library. And there's actually another edition after this. And then together with Jeffrey Burgess, he wrote this book, which is just great. Then he wrote this book, The Eloquent Oboe, 1640 to 1760, and this is the reference work. And then finally, this book called The End of Early Music, and it talks about the difference between rhetorical playing and modern long line conservatory style. Campus and that one kind of enough. Oh, and then if you want to read more about Bruce, there's a great article written by Jeffrey Burgess, Piper at the Gates of Dawn, it's listed there. Jörg Schäffler, Viennese, he was the principal of the Consensus Musicus Armenkorps. He participated in that first historic series of complete Bach cantatas. I think you can hear a little bit of this. He had several notable students, David Reisenberg, Paul Hailburn, Paul Goodwin, Richard Earle. Interestingly, he spent some time in playing in the NHK Symphony in Tokyo and spread the Viennese oboe there. So, finally we come to four American makers of the Hautboy. I narrowed it down to just American makers and the established ones. There's many more around the world, but you may know some of these. Harry Vasquez, he's here at the conference today. I suggest you go up and say hello to him. Or some of his facts there. Born in Amsterdam, raised in London. He was modern oboist, symphony oboist, played in all those orchestras. He began building in 1974, and here's a list of models he makes and his website. Sam Dalton. So Sam, he studied modern oboe with Alan Fogel and played in various orchestras. Began building in 1976, and there his model goes to. He made all these instruments, all the instruments. Joel Robinson. He started out working for 11 historical instruments in New York City. He developed the Saxon oboe together with Steve Hammer, moved to the West Coast, and there's a list of his models. Website. And finally, Mary Kirkpatrick, so we heard facts. She offers, she's one of the people who specializes in low pitch oboes, A392. And interestingly, she only uses hand tools and a treadle pump powered lathe. So, question and answer. I'm sure you've got plenty of questions. Why are you? Your questions. Go ahead.
So the majority of us have modern oboes, but we constantly play Baroque music.
Yeah.
What tips can you give to do justice to the style that was originally written for, and the sound you originally wanted to get?
Well, you're probably expecting this answer, but I would say take up the Baroque oboe. Barring that, read about rhetorical style, Baroque style, and how it differs from modern style. It was actually a paradigm shift that happened in all the arts, but especially in music, around the time of the French Revolution and the Industrial Revolution, music went from being a craft to becoming an absolute art. So you had music in the 18th century that was written by craftsmen like Bach or Handel, and they wrote it for audiences of their time. Typically, you wouldn't have heard of music older than maybe 5 or 10 years in the 18th century. And it was often the composer was the performer, too. But we went from that to having this canon of music, these masterpieces that exist up in the heavens and, you know, are almost untouchable by performers. You know, the symphonies of Beethoven or Brahms, they exist as some kind of ideal, and, you know, performers can only dare to approach performing them. You know, I mean, that's the whole mindset that developed around concert music. You know, there was some writer who wrote about how modern concert halls are really museums of music. And it wasn't that way in the 18th century. Music was contemporary in the 18th century. It was played by contemporary musicians, and also, I should say, it was the music on the page, what you played as a musician, was only maybe half or three quarters of the story. It was like jazz music. You were given, a keyboard player was given a bass line with some numbers and would create a whole accompaniment. The soloist would look at a part and then add ornaments and place figures in a certain way, adding phrasing and dynamics. The music on the page was just half the story. You know, fast forward to our time, and the music is all written out. It's, you know, notated with slurs and dynamics and retards and all this kind of thing. You didn't have that in the 18th century. But I sort of answer your question. Go ahead.
So do you have a preference to low frequencies versus A440?
Well, first of all, A440 was actually a genuine tuning in Italy. But and the other problem is that the A415, which is A is in fact a G sharp. It's actually only one of many pitches that existed in the 18th century. But it's a standard. So if you want to go jam with somebody in another city and bring your Baroque axe, that's what you have to bring. Even though there's other possibilities.
So if the instrument's made well, it doesn't really matter.
Well, you have to decide what pitch you're going to play at. But most people who play period instruments nowadays play in 415.
Yes. If you are an amateur player of the modern oboe, we're a species which couldn't even exist but for smart people making reeds for us. Can you survive playing these instruments?
Yeah, that's a good question. I have struggled with reeds for 45 years, and I can't say that I've solved the problem. I wanted to tell you a little bit of this one. I don't have a good solution for you.
Are there people that are willing to
you can buy reeds. There are people who sell reeds for world oboe. They're not bad. But even more so than the modern oboe, you've got to really tailor your reeds to your instrument and your playing style. You got to it'd be next to possible to use commercial reeds. But maybe there are some people who do it. There's a gal in New York City named Kristen Olson. She has a company called Reed Lizard. And her reeds are pretty good for Baroque oboe. So this is, I just took delivery of this a few weeks ago. This is a brand new oboe.
Thank you.
Mozart oboe quartet.
What is that one pitched in? The one you just
this one is pitched in A430, which is the standard for classical instruments. So about a quarter tone below mine. Yes.
Between, do you find a difference when making Gilmore and for the Hautboy, that a bigger challenge in one reed, specifically like English horn versus
Oboe
modern Oboe
reeds,
they're like a different beast.
Well, there's different approaches. This is actually made on the same cane, same shaper, but it's a little shorter. I just sort of hit on that by accident. So I think most players, their regular Oboe the more reeds are pretty close. In my certainly are. Any other questions? So now we can do the demo or the trial. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Sir, with the classical oboe, is that like a flop?
That's a float.
And how do you float? How do you do the F sharp fingerings on that?
Okay, well, see, this gives you a little hint on how we get into the modern oboe, right? Because on the modern oboe, you've got this F-sharp problem. And it's also the problem on the saxophone, for example. And flute has a different solution to that. In the modern oboe, they add a little, if you're playing F-sharp, there's a little vent that opens here, right? So on this, they put this key over here that you have to hit with your pinky. This is really strange. It's hard to get used to. But it works. It brings it up into equal temperament. Because if you play it without it, or if you play it with a broke finger, it's more mean tone. That's how the broke finger would be with the... technically, it's kind of hard to get used to. Any other questions? Yes?
So any idea how they made the reeds for these then? I mean, as far as would it be the same concept of the fork and the blah, blah, blah?
I'll refer you, first of all, to this article that Jeffrey Brodersen wrote. These are several dozen surviving English oboe reeds, and take a look at that. The bottom line is, I had a look at that article. The bottom line is that oboe reeds in the 18th and 19th century, early 19th anyway, were radically different. They kind of looked like small bassoon reeds. And also, there was another approach that they had. This is theorized, something called progressive or tapered gouging. Do you know about that? Yeah. And evidently, Viennese oboes do this too. So the canes gouge progressively inside from back to tip. So it's thickest at the back and thinnest at the tip. And then you fold over, tie it on, and then all you have to do, supposedly, is scrape off the bark at the tip, and you've got a plain reed. And this is what, sorcery. reeds were made. There's a treatise by Otzi, bassoon treatise, where he talks about this for bassoon reeds. And a lot of players of period bassoon do this now. They progressively gouge on the inside. You're shaking your head. Yeah. Okay. Four were tied on, and then just scrape the bark off, and the thing plays. Because now the tip is so thin, it's been gouged so thin on the inside. But I've never tried that. I made one day when I get old. So, what I have is I have four reeds, and I have some sterosol if you want me to put it in the water, or if you don't mind sharing reeds. What would you like me to do? Sterosol?
There's some right here.
Oh, it's on the table. I don't know. So, where's the sign up sheet? Oh,
we emailed you.
Oh, it's in here. What? It's in my email.
We emailed you.
It's in here.
Why don't you let anyone that wants to play it?
Yeah, but I thought I'd take the people who contacted you first. So, is Barbara back here? Okay. So you're first?
Oh, boy.
So what do you
want to do?
Like this, it's okay, but when you add these two fingers, it becomes a really nice note. Without a note. Actually, it's a good note to start on, to warm up on. So C, I'll just play it, okay?
Yep.
The rest of it is like minor, except for the F. But there is a four cap, right? I don't know how many you still have to work at. Like an E with this finger lifted. There's no plateaus or anything here. And then the B is like an E with this finger lifted. And Molly wants to play, right? Okay. And you're also an Oboe, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Does she want
that? Well, I think the friends are going to share saliva, right?
Yeah. All
right, let's start with more awkward.
Oh,
we
have them in our school.
Yeah.
We don't have
the
picture.
Yeah.
But it's a little good on the start. Again, you've got the modern type. That's the neat thing about the Baroque oboe is you can just put the reed in your mouth and play. You don't have to set your aperture like you were playing, you know, Brahms or something. And the rest of the way is like modern, except there's an F, forked F. Down is like modern except for this fork down. Fork F. So this is, start with a C. D. It's a real tactile thing playing this instrument. You can feel where the holes are. Your ring finger is drifting up. That's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
You're still getting a C.
Yeah, I know.
you might have to spend some time with it and feel where the holes are.
Yeah, I'm hearing.
Okay. Timothy. Timothy is a guy from my our area, and he's a pro, so. I don't know
if my read will work here.
But no, I probably won't. Yeah. So you should use this for this. But you've played before, so.
Do you mind if I dip in the sticker?
Oh, yeah. Obviously, between Baroque and. See a little higher pitch, right? And I have to remember to press the octave key. I hardly ever do that, you know? Obviously for B and C, it stops at A.
And that's the same long Baroque fingering for those, or is it different?
No, I use a short for A. Oh, you can use a short for B too. But the C is, unlike, you don't have to add an E flat key. For the C is just these four fingers, and it's real nice note. Sharp, so look what they did.
Oh, yeah.
Or. That blows my mind how they did that. But in the upper octave, I think just the C key by itself worked. Mm. But the funny thing is that, well, the bad thing is, these keys are so close.
Easy to hit one.
Yeah, it's easy to hit the other. I'm sorry, I took it away from you.
No, not at all. I'm monopolizing it. I apologize.
No, I'll do it.
Thanks so much.
And one of these days I'll be able to play this one.
For tomorrow, we have to clear out some of these pianos. We have because we hit capacity twice today. We're trying to just reconfigure the room.
How about, can we do maybe 5, 10 more minutes? Is that okay?
Can you want to 8 more minutes? Go until about 3:40. That sound okay?
Okay, sure.
Thank you. Amazing.
As you said, there are only two extra entities. examples, this is otherwise we would know about them.
Isn't it a beautiful song?
It is.
Oh, it's always wanted to be.
Solos of Barbara Rowley. It's published by Boozing and Hawks. I don't have a,
don't have it with me, but it's all the the best solos, the most difficult solos of G.S. Bach. Yeah, it's a number, like 300 different cult solos by G.S. Bach.
Mm-hmm. So I wanted to show you that I just got my solo.